Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to Magheralin Parish Church. And we're so delighted that you've joined us this morning. Just that you know, this is the first of a little mini series from Bishop David McClay, where we're going to be looking at discipleship today, leadership, and apostleship. And we pray that you'll be really blessed with these themes that Bishop David will unpack for us in the coming couple of weeks. Just before we begin with our first song, I want to pray that God would bless our time. So let's pray. Lord Jesus Christ, fill our worship with grace, that every thought, word, and deed would be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Come, thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise a mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love.
Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I've come, and I pray by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. To grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let that grace now like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. I'm prone to from sinning, I shall see thy lovely face, clothed then in blood washed linen. How I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry, take my ransomed soul away. Send thy angels now to carry me to realms of endless days. Send thine angels now to carry me to realms of endless days.
Now we come to the part of our service where we confess. So let's pray. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought and word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. And may the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our confessed sins, heal and strengthen us by his Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen.
In today's intercessions, we're looking at the theme of discipleship. So we're going to use a few verses from the book of Acts to pray through. Let's pray. It says this: they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Father God, as disciples of you, we pray that we would honour you in each of these ways. Lord, that we would honour you in the way that we read your word, that we read it according to the apostles' teaching, which has been established shortly after that you died and rose again. Lord, I pray that we would continue to meet together as we come out of lockdown. Lord, I pray that we would find it easier and easier to connect with each other and to see the great encouragement there is of being together with the people of God. And Lord, we pray that we would always, every day, remember you, and we would remember the sacrifice of your precious blood for us. And Lord, that we would again be re-envisioned by what it is to pray, to see prayers answered. Lord, I pray that each person here would be inspired to pray when we talk to you, that you would just take our prayers and that you would just dynamically transform us in that place of prayer in order that we can be more like you. Lord, I pray, where it says everyone was filled with awe and many wonders and miraculous signs were done. Lord, I pray that you would move again in power, that you would awaken each person's heart, that you would put inside of us a fresh fire and a passion for Jesus, and that would overflow as we encounter people who need your answers to prayer, that we would be emboldened to pray and to see answers to prayer. And Lord, that you would move among your people with signs and wonders, that you would speak with words of prophecy, and that lives would be transformed because you are a miracle working God. And Lord, we know that you love to show how real you are. It says all the believers were together and had everything in common. I pray, Lord, that you would just really give us one heart for the mission and vision of what you want to do in these days as we come out of lockdown. Lord, would you give each person a fresh vision of what you want to do in them and through them, because each one of us is called according to your purposes. And I pray, Father God, that we would capture that vision, that we would be re-energized to serve you and to live for you wherever we are and whatever we're doing. And it says every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with sincere and glad hearts, praising God and enjoying the favour of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Lord, would you just revive us? Would you do something to transform our attitudes, and that you would show us what it is that you have for the future? Lord, let us approach this new season with a hope and a real desire to be together, to meet with you, and a real expectation of what you are going to do. Because Lord, we know that you're always on the move, you're always working. And so Father God, I pray that we would just be overflowing with you, that we'd be excited with you, and Lord, that we would tell others about you. Lord, that whatever opportunities we get, that we would pray and we would see you answer, and people would realise that you're the true and living God. Lord, We ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And we're going to finish with the Lord's Prayer, which says this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory for ever and ever. Amen.
Jesus said that if I thirst, I should come to him. No one else can satisfy, I should come to him. Jesus said if I am weak, I should come to him. No one else can be my strength, I should come to him. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong.
A reading from the book of Acts, Acts chapter 2. The theme of this reading is discipleship, and the theme that I'll be looking at a little later in our service is that of discipleship, one of the themes that we looked at together at our recent Diocesan Synod. Acts chapter 2, beginning to read at verse 42. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had everything in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So as we turn to your word together to look at this theme of discipleship, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts of all our hearts be this day and always acceptable in your sight, O God, our refuge and our Redeemer. Amen. So this is the first in a little sermon series of three sermons, three talks for churches right across our diocese over these summer weeks. Each of them on one of the themes that I spoke into at our recent diocesan synod. So three sermons, three ships. Today's sermon, discipleship. The next one will be on leadership, and the third talk on apostleship. So today we're looking together at discipleship, and we turn to the first of the three passages in the book of Acts that we're going to base these talks on, the passage that was read earlier from Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 47. These verses follow the Holy Spirit having been poured out on the early church, and a group of 120 believers were changed forever. We read, all were together in one place. We read in verse 1, when the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. This is, of course, in all of our churches and indeed right across society in many ways a season of regrouping, of regathering, of being able to come together again. In our churches, to be able to come together in real space again. And please do return to your parish church as soon as you possibly can and as soon as that's right and safe for you to do so. These 120 in this passage in Acts chapter 2 and the many who became Christians in the church of the first century went on to grow as disciples. They became strong followers of Jesus Christ. And we learn a lot about discipleship. We learn a lot about growing as disciples and as Christians and as followers of Jesus in these few verses, verses 42 to 47 of Acts 2. We learn that growing as followers of Jesus is actually part and parcel of what it means to be a Christian. And discipleship is something, first of all, we discover in these verses that happens within us, inside us. It's also something then that impacts life around us. And thirdly, it's something that impacts our lives beyond us. So, first of all, discipleship, the work of God, the work of the Holy Spirit within us. Verses 41 and 42. So those who received his word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. In those couple of verses, there's this sense of God working within us, God working inside, as it were, his disciples, his followers. There's, first of all, receiving God's word. There's hearing God's word. And in order to hear God's word, we need to be present to hear the word of God being taught, present in our buildings, present at Sunday services, present at midweek gatherings, present at online opportunities to hear God's word being taught, present at online Bible study opportunities. present at Zoom Bible study opportunities. And Zoom's a great aid for us as we move forward. For example, those of you who have small children, one parent can nowadays stay at home and join the Bible study on Zoom while the other goes and meets in a church building or a church hall or a home to study God's Word. Those with health issues are able to worship online, to be taught God's Word online, to receive from the teaching of God's Word online or at a Zoom gathering. However we do it, whether it's online or whether it's gathering with others in a building, we need to be sure that we are those who are regularly continuing to hear God's Word. And in hearing God's Word, receiving it internally within us, being transformed, being reshaped within as disciples of Jesus, as we gladly and openly receive God's Word. And then go on to publicly identify with Christ, publicly confessing, as these early Christians did, that we too believe in God the Father, that we too believe that Jesus Christ is Lord, that we too believe in the Holy Spirit. And then if we haven't been baptized as infants, that we are baptized as adults, as adult believers, or maybe renewing the vows that were made for us at baptism through a confirmation service or in some other way. These early disciples were baptized. These early disciples were taught. These early disciples were men and women who were changed within, deep within the very depths of who they were. They were changed. The Bible was their diet. The Bible was their food. They devoured, quite literally, God's Word, and they grew and became strong disciples. Please ensure that you're a disciple, a follower of Jesus who is being fed, who regularly is reading the Bible and studying the Bible, who's regularly meeting with others to study the Bible together with others, who is regularly enjoying fellowship with others, carrying each other's burdens, sharing each other's concerns, praying into each other's lives, receiving prayer and praying into the lives of others. These disciples in Acts chapter 2 grew internally. They grew within, and they grew within because of how God's Word and God's presence and God's people were feeding into their lives. And we read in verse 46, day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food. They received their food with glad and generous hearts. I love the way that one of this more recent songs that we are familiar with puts it in a prayer, refiner's fire. My heart's one desire is to be holy, holy within, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my Master, ready to do your will. Discipleship is a work of God within. Then secondly, discipleship involves a work of God around us. Verse 43, awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. God's at work here in people's lives. And because God's at work in people's lives, those around them and society around them are being impacted and changed. Something akin to a holy fear seems to impact others, the lives of those around these early disciples. We might call it conviction, but something like a holy fear impacts those around these early followers of Jesus. You see, that shouldn't surprise us, because disciples, Christians carry within them. We carry within us the very presence of God, the very presence of the Holy Spirit. The very presence of God lives in us, so we should expect that our lives would therefore impact and bring transformation to the lives of those around us, leading them to turn to Christ, leading them to turn away from living without Christ, to turn away from a life of sin, leading them to receive Christ, leading them to also become his disciples, to also become his followers. Disciples make disciples, other disciples, of those around them. Those first century Christians, those first century disciples in the book of Acts and in these verses in Acts 2 were held in very, very high regard by those who were not disciples. We read in verse 47, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. Or verse 45, they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. The lives of those around these early Christians were being changed. The lives of those that these early Christians came in contact with were being impacted. Disciples, you and I, whether we're clergy or bishops or vestry people or church treasurers or Sunday school teachers or youth leaders or people who are part of our congregations in whatever way we're part of a local congregation, our lives should be impacting the lives of those around us. You and I so convinced ourselves that the Word of God is transformational, that we so live out God's Word, that we so live as followers of Jesus, that we so live out the life of being a disciple, that those around us are changed and challenged to follow Christ too. Disciples, therefore, are men and women who are convinced that God, the Holy Spirit, has so changed their lives that he's able to change the lives of others. Verse 39 captures this, the promises for you and for your children and for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. Everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. Filled with the Holy Spirit, you and I will be men and women who will love God with passion and with energy and with fervor and with something that's deeply rooted within us, but then begins to impact those around us. We will be those who love to pray, who love to break bread, who love God's word, who love his people, who love to worship, and who so love Jesus that others will be led to love him too and to fall in love with him and to give their lives to him. In the church, we have, however, too often settled for a substandard, inconsistent life as disciples, as followers of Jesus. It's been too easy at times for others to point the finger at us and how we're not consistent in our Christian living or in our Christian walk. So let's, in these days, all of us, each of us, allow the Holy Spirit to really search us deep, deep within and to challenge our inconsistencies and to change our inconsistencies so that we not only talk the talk, but we walk the walk. Let's live like Jesus. Let's, as learners, as disciples, learn and discover what it is and what it looks like to be more like Jesus. And may my life and your life and the life of anyone who calls themselves a Christian be such that we, our discipleship impacts the lives of those around us. When we're a disciple of Jesus, there will be growth that will take place that will impact the life of people around us. It's part and parcel of Christian discipleship, continual growing, continual growth with people consistently and continually around us, choosing to follow Jesus too. Verse 47, praising God and having favour with all the people, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Little question, are there people around you and me? Are there others in our parishes, in our communities, in our circle of friends and circle of acquaintances that in these days are being drawn closer to Jesus and who are becoming disciples because of your witness and mine? Discipleship is something that impacts us within. Discipleship is something that impacts life around us. And then thirdly, discipleship is something that impacts life beyond us. Life beyond you and life beyond me. We read in verse 45, they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. Our reach, like the reach of the early church, needs to extend beyond ourselves, beyond what's happening within us. It needs to extend even beyond those around us to those beyond us. Eventually, the life of these early Christians would impact the nations, would impact first of all Jerusalem, but then the gospel would go out beyond Jerusalem to the nations around. Just two chapters further on in Acts chapter 4, we read these words, and when they prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and continued to speak the word of God with boldness. While it is true that great things happen immediately here in Acts 2 in Jerusalem and in the chapters that follow, the good news of Jesus at work in people's lives spreads. The gospel very quickly goes beyond Jerusalem. When persecution and opposition came to those early Christians, not only is the place where they pray shaken, but the places to which they're scattered are shaken. And ultimately the whole earth, the whole world is shaken. Today, discipleship, being a disciple of Jesus, being a follower of Jesus, will involve people being shaken in such a way that society around us, the communities around us, but the very earth needs to be shaken in today's world and in today's church by this incredible gospel, this great good news that has been entrusted to us. Discipleship impacts us within. Discipleship impacts those around us. But discipleship also needs to impact the world beyond us. Today's church needs a real awakening, a real empowering, where the Holy Spirit, yes, impacts us deep, deep within our own hearts and lives in a way that influences and reaches those around us, but in a way then too that shakes the earth. Verse 43, awe came upon every soul. And many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. Or verse 45, they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. The circles of influence are extending. Verse 47, praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. True discipleship will move us from being not just good students, but to becoming a church, to becoming men and women who once again, and this is not a cliche, but who once again might shake the earth for Jesus. Might shake the earth, the whole earth, for Jesus. May the Spirit of God so come down upon his church throughout the world. May the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, so come down and fill your life and my life in these days, that we would shake the earth again. For discipleship is a work of God within us. It's a work of God around us. And it is a work of God beyond us. The hymn writer captured it. Restore, O Lord, the honor of your name. In works of sovereign power, come shake the earth again that all may see. And come with reverent fear to the living God whose kingdom shall outlast the year. The work that begins within, captured here. Bend us, O Lord, where we are hard and cold. In your refiner's fire, come purify the gold. But the work of God then, discipleship, goes beyond just a work within us to a work around us and beyond us. Restore, O Lord, in all the earth your fame. And in our time, revive the church that bears your name. And in your anger, Lord, remember mercy. O living God, whose mercy shall outlast the years. Let us pray. Lord God, Jesus told us to go and to make disciples. In these days, may your church throughout this diocese of Down Under Moor so set about making disciples that many, that we would all be changed within, that our churches would increasingly impact those around us, and that, Lord God, you would shake the earth again by a work of your Spirit far beyond us. And so enable us, Lord, to be the sort of disciple that would make other disciples. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest, and without you, I fall apart. You're the one who guides my heart. Lord, I need you.
Sing runs.
when temptation comes my way. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and Savior.
Well, folks, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We hope you've been blessed, and we hope that you're looking forward to the next couple of weeks where we'll hear more from Bishop David. I'm just going to close with a blessing. Go out today and in the week ahead, remembering who you are and to whom you belong. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.